So let me start today with giving a short summary of what we reached yesterday. So we formulated the Plancherel theory for FI Deca. I will not care about for a while. As we've seen in this converse statement, in fact, the converse result is already true if you forget about the constants, because all the information in the invariants is already contained in the Q rational, or Q, I say Q rational while I use V as a variable, V is the square root. So it's in the Q-rational part of these Plancherel densities. And so I want to remind the key features of this. And about computing these positive constants, there are completely separate techniques, and I will discuss those in the lecture at the conference. So this has to do with the uniform classification of discrete series in terms of elliptic representations of the bio group, the affine bio group, and Dirac induction. Then you get all the techniques you need in order to compute the rational constants, the finer structure that you need for the stability of the packet. So it's very important information. But for now, we will just ignore it because I know we can fix it later. So the key features. I want to remind, and also in fact formulate it a little bit better. Yesterday we were just making our hands dirty, so we came up with a big mess. So let's just tidy it up. So if C inside the dual, let's see, the tempered dual, it's a topological space, is a component, then the central projection, so this is the central characters, so recall that the center of the Hecke algebra is just this bio group orbits in this torus. So this can be described by a component of this central support in the spectral decomposition formula we described yesterday, and that is given by a residual coset, as we defined it yesterday. In fact, you have to take the tempered part of a residual coset for some, for a unique up to non action residual coset. And recall that these residual cosets are defined in terms of the mu function. It just means that the number of poles minus the number of zeros is at least the codimension, or is equal to the codimension, but that turns out to be the same thing. So this is the first statement. So we have a very good idea of the various components and how to describe them. If you restrict the spectral measure of the trace of H to this component, then you get a constant which depends on the component only, times, and then the pullback of, the push forward of the pullback under the central character map, if you restrict it to C regular, of this smooth measure mu L that was described yesterday. S L. And this turns out to be a smooth finite covering. In any case, so in terms of the formulas we wrote down yesterday, this is completely out of control, up to this constant that we leave unspecified. It depends only on the component. Then C. If we take a discrete series, so then we have an isolated point in the spectrum, then in fact that's equivalent to saying that the central character is the component attached to the residual point. And in fact, in terms of that residual point, we can describe the formal degree to a large extent. So in case C, the formal degree of delta is equal to some constant again, and then this function MRV, which is nothing but a residue, an appropriate residue in an appropriate sense. So this is the residue mu regularized R, evaluated at R of mu at R. So one has to, of course, do a lot of work to make this precise, but we defined specifically in terms of the root data what this function V is, M is of V. Okay, and this again is a constant. Positive. Constant. And and important, here we have that these constants, they depend maybe on all the parameters, but if you scale the parameters simultaneously, you get the same thing. So that's why I call them constants. Because in the relevant situation for us, you will only see the scale. And now we look at the special case where the lattice is P and all the parameters are equal. And then we had that the support of this measure mu is S is the disjoint union over all L in T residual of this component SL that I described here. And we saw that this is in bijection with the set of equivalence classes of tempered unremified language parameters. And the map was very simple. If you have a class here, then you map it to the orbit, the image of this extended Frobenius element in the Regular. And then it means that you can express these formulas we had yesterday for mu L and for this M function in terms of this Langmuir parameter, because we have new parametrization. And so that's not in terms of points defined by the pole structure of the new function, but in terms of Langmuir parameters. And then you can verify that the statement of Hiraga, Ichino, Ikeda is true, So this is a theory, goes back in fact. I think the formulas go back a long time, but this was before even Hiraga, Ichino, and Ikeda formulated their conjecture. And it is an easy verification, so it's not, I mean, I cannot easily give an appropriate reference. But maybe certainly Margherita should be mentioned for the split exceptional groups. So it's true that for all adjoint, for G adjoint simple, or even quasi-simple, and unramified. So it's this over an unramified extension. So up to positive constants, independent of Q. This H by I 1 and 2 hold. For Iwamori spherical representations. And well, that is already big, a big step. And we also see that there is an important role here for these residual cosets, so let me make some remarks on their properties. So the first one is that for any coset of a subtorus, we have the inequality that the number of poles containing L minus the number of zeros containing L, it's always less or equal than the codimension of L. So it is, the maximum is attained exactly for the residual cosets. This holds true for all parameters. It's a very remarkable fact. It's highly non-trivial. If you just look at the root system, you start to look for such points, and you, I mean, so it's a non-trivial statement. And a corollary of it is that there are finitely many. Residual cosets. Corollary A and corollary B. No, I shouldn't call them A. 1, 2. That is that the measure, mu L, is a smooth measure. Fact that I already mentioned, but you see the point is, if you are on a residual coset, then with respect to this co-dimension, you are already of maximal pole order. So there is no room for this measure whose poles correspond to having extra mu poles on the temp locus to get more. So this is an important fact. And let's see, and B is, oh, that's also a cube fact about residual cosets. So suppose I have one at the parameter V. There exists a residual coset defined over the whole parameter ring lambda. So remember that we viewed our torus as a torus over base lambda. So it's a residual coset over lambda, such that the specialization at V is just the specialization of this guy defined over lambda. So anything that you find is the specialization of a generic family. So these we call generic residual process. But it's not unique. So there are finitely many in general. But if you have, well, okay, I will make more comments on this later. But this is always the case, and this is important for deformation theory. If you want to start deforming your tempered spectrum with respect to parameters, then you have to pay respect to how these residual cosets can deform. But you can have that, for example, one Wellgren orbit of residual points at the equal parameter situation will split up in a couple of such orbits if you deform a little bit.
Do they
differ
over the whole
Q
or only on a
Z-speed answer? Over the whole Q. Yeah. So if you have a point which is generic, so a residual point, so here is another thing that I should have said when you asked this question, but I think it will come now. Then this specialization at the parameter is residual if and only if this M function, which is a regular rational function, but regular on the locus Q, if that is at V specialized non-zero. So that gives exactly. So it is defined over the whole space, but it's not at every specialization residual. And in fact, this is the complement of finitely many subtori in the parameter space Q. And for each of these generic residual points, of which you have finitely many, you have another set of parameters, which is sort of massive, where you do have that this is non-zero. And then we have the support theory that says it does carry the discrete series. And if it's not, if this is zero, then it's no longer residual, and so then it doesn't carry discrete series. And so finally, if you have a discrete series, then there exists a unique generic residual point R lambda, well, that exists a unique orbit W naught R lambda in T lambda naught W naught generic residual such that the central character of delta is the specialization at your parameter. So here I should put the V here, because that is what I all the time did for some strange reason, but otherwise it will be confusing. So this is strange, because so it says that you have a stronger invariant than just the central character. Because if you have a discrete series, then well, your central character can be, if you start deforming it, split up in several orbits of discrete series points, or of these residue points. But every discrete series is attached to a unique one. And then, in fact, there is also a deformation of the discrete series, which follows exactly this deformation of the central character. So there is a unique orbit attached to it, which gives you the central character, and there is a unique continuous in a Schwarz sense, Schwarz-Norm sense. There is a unique family of discrete series, let's say V prime goes to the delta of V prime, which is all the time discrete series. So the discrete series, they have a sort of perfect deformation theory. So it's all the time in the discrete series for these Hecke algebras in a neighborhood, analytically in the neighborhood of your original point V, parameter V, such that the central character of this delta V sine is the orbit of this generic point, but now evaluate it at V prime. So these are very useful facts, in fact, when you want to compute the rational constants. But as I said, for now we don't forget about this. But this was the state of affairs, and I spent, of course, way too much time explaining all this. So now I want to discuss spectral tensor maps. So today and tomorrow we will discuss this. And today I want to do the Cuspidal case. So start with a short review of the unipotent types. And affine Hecke algebras. Now I changed my notation a little bit, so the base ring will be lambda 0 is C V plus or minus 1. So it's a single variable now. The square of the variable is called Q. And, well, okay, so it will typically be interpreted as the cardinality of the residue field. So I view it as a formal parameter which is very appropriate in the world of unipotent representations because there are no bad primes. And so this is a, so treat it as a formal parameter. And for now, so G is quasi-split, and I consider an inner twist, and then I refer to the inner form G as GU, and I will also take G is the points over the maximal unramified extension, so this is G bar F unramified, and so then my group of points as before I can write, so G U of F will be now in this notation the G and then Frobenius U fixed points. And so to take this group as a sort of the main character is also in line with treating the cardinality of the residue field as a formal parameter. So this group, by Gottlieb's isomorphism, so we can we have this bijection. This in bijection with the the character group of the center modulo the action of the Frobenius or the co-invariance with respect to the action of the Frobenius, and this so theta is the action of the Frobenius on the dual side, so the L group I write as G check theta. And so this I can write as omega mod 1 minus theta Omega, where Omega is isomorphic to P mod Q, which reminds me of one thing. I take G to be of adjoint type. Okay, and then we had the steering of Lustig and Morris. And if I take a parabolic subgroup, so I take a type of the unipotent type, so I take P from minus U sigma, where this is a parabolic subgroup which is F Frobenius stable, and sigma is a unipotent representation, Kussmaul. So then I get a type. So this is a type of G. And the Hecker algebra of this type is an affine Hecker algebra. Over this base ring lambda zero, such that for all simple reflections, depending on this type. So the value of the parameter is a power of V integral, where NS is integral. And we normalize it, the trace of this thing, by the trace of 1 is V tau, which is the degree of sigma over the volume. So this is the setup, and then Lustig has defined this category of unipotent representations, so C unipotent G from minus U category unipotent smooth representations is the direct product over all conjugacy classes of such pairs of the categories which this type defines, C, T, G, from G. And so it's a finite product of Bernstein. And then Lustig showed that if you look at all the irreducible objects in this category, you can partition this in packets parametrized by the unramified Langlands parameters. So the irreducibles tempered, let's say, of this category G from minus U is a partitioning in unramified tempered Langlands parameters modulo equivalence of a packet pi, and I described this already, how to parameterize these packets conjecturally. And so then the special case, And here is, yeah, so this is in my injection that is set by SO5 chi U. This is now a character of omega extending the character of GU associated to GU via the Cotterits isomorphism. Alright, so I'm saying this wrong, sorry, this is an element of, so it's a character on Z-check star, which is now, so in Mark, if you look at this US1 case, so consider US1, and P is the Kiwa-Pauli, and sigma is the trivial. So then we are back in the previous situation, the Iwa-Hori case for the quasi-split form. So then HT is the Iwa-Hori Hecker algebra. Of this G and with normalization dt is V minus V inverse to the power minus the rank, and that's the F rank of G. And so then we have our theorem of yesterday, that we know already how to, that we can establish already there up to constants this conjecture. So the big problem becomes how to deal with the other types, P, sigma, because they give you smaller rank Hecker algebras with unequal parameters, higher powers of V, and how do you somehow compare to the spectrum of the Iwa-Hori Hecker algebra in this whole cloud of Hecker algebras. And that's the basic problem. And you want to do this in such a way, of course, that it is comparable with Lustig's classification, and you want to show that it satisfies these HII conjectures. So that's the task. So today I want to look at the Cuspidal case. And that's the easiest but also the most fundamental thing to do. So I look at Cuspidal unipotent characters. So now we have T be a maximal type. So we have P, U, sigma. So it's a unipotent type. For GU, some inner form, with PU maximal parabolic. And then the Hecker algebra, as Alan explained, becomes very simple, and it's just the group. So there is a natural action of this group omega acting on the affine diagram, and then you want to, or of omega, the theta invariance in omega acting on the affine diagram, and then you want to see which of these elements preserve P, and the group ring over the base ring lambda zero is now the Hecker And the only information that is further stored in here is the normalization of the trace, and that is a very important function which we know is this degree of sigma volume of P of U. And these are the Cuspidal unipotent degrees divided by these volumes that Lustig computed painstakingly for all the different types of finite groups, all the finite groups of E-type. They are beautiful expressions, products of cyclotomic polynomials, times powers of Q, and then some Q minus 1 factors as well. And so that's all stored in there. So now, if we are given this, we need to find now a residual point in, let's say, a lambda values residual point in our torus. Maybe, so this is the maximal torus of the Lehmann's dual group, but yeah, the Hecke algebras have called it all the time just T. So now I don't know, I cannot decide, should I put the check on it or not? You may decide, show it. If you, I put a check on it, and no, Jessica doesn't think so. Okay, I'm convinced. So we have this orbit of residual points that we need to find for the Imamori-Hecke algebra. Of the quasi-split form, such that the conjecture one of HII holds, so the degree of sigma over volume P is, and we know that up to a constant, so this dot means up to constants. It should be the residue of the mu function for the Imamori-Hecke algebra, where all the parameters are equal. And we know that this is this M function attached to the generic residual point. So let's call this equation star. And as we've seen, such a residual point, W0R, corresponds uniquely to a Langlands parameter. And we also know, such that the right-hand side here I don't know actually what this Q means. So this evaluation is equal to the adjoint gamma factor. I do know what it means. I want to ignore it. So again, up to a constant zero, and then of the adjoint representation of the L group and our fixed self-dual measure. And this is the equation we already know by the statement of yesterday. So if we can solve this equation, then we have a Langlands parameter that does satisfy the HII conjecture for this representation, for this Cusperian representation. So let's look at how this works out in practice. For example, one, so let G is PGL M plus 1. And that the inner form be the most extreme case, the division algebra. So here D is a division algebra of degree m plus 1. And so on this side, it has essentially only one discrete series, non-ramified, or discrete non-ramified Langlands parameter, namely the regular parameter. So it's given phi zero. So it's given by phi zero restricted to the Weyl group is trivial, and on the SO2 it sends the unipotent element to a regular grouping. And now the pair phi 0 1 trivial here corresponds to the Steinberg representation. And the formal degree, you can compute with the formulas we have. Formal degree of this guy is given by this m function. And if you work that out for the regular parameter, it's a cute simple computation. So it's 1 over m plus 1, 1 over m plus 1 q, the q number. So n q means for me v to the n minus v to the minus n over v minus v. On the other hand, you have the anisotropic form, inner form. So that has only one parabolic subgroup. So, on the other hand, so GU1 is the intersection of all the unramified characters. The kernel of those. So that is PU, that's the only parabolic of GU because it's an anisotropic group. And well, we have the quotient GU, GU1 is a cyclic group of order n plus 1, and the volume of our parabolic turns out to be, well, in the Haar measures as we define them, we have to do v to the power minus the rank, and then we have to take the number of points in the reduction on p, and that is v to the minus n q to the m minus 1 over q minus 1, and that's exactly m plus 1 q, as I define it. Or did I say? Yeah. And you see that it exactly comes out right. So we get correct. We can associate, we can assign these representations corresponding to the type PU TRIF to the Langlands parameter phi zero, because and it matches the HI degree. Now this is a very simple example. It's in line with the old observation in the work of Heinrich Chandra, that the formal degree of a discrete series representation matches the Weyl denominator formula for the finite dimensional representation at the corresponding central character of the compact form. And the point here is that, well, there is no choice because there is only one residual point anyway. So now, but in any case, we see it fits. So now the second case, G is G2, and phi is the subregular unipotent orbit. So the short loops, so that corresponds to W0R. yes. And so in the packet, so the group S5 is now S3, the permutation group on three letters. And in Springer theory, it's well known that in this case there is one missing representation. So, however, rho is the sign, is not corresponding, does not correspond to a Iwahori-spherical representation. But then you look at the Cusperal representations that you have available here, and we take now the maximal parabolic, the O points of G. So then the reduction is the G2 points, the group over FQ. So this has a cuspidal unipotent, it has several cuspidal unipotents, but it has one unipotent named by Lustig G2-1, and it has degree 1 over 6 V plus V inverse times squared times V squared plus 1 plus V minus 2 in our normalization. And lo and behold, this is exactly the residue of the mu function at this residue point, which corresponds to this subregular parameter. So that means that we have to, and this is the only cuspidal one that has this degree, and so you get a unique matching. You have a unique hole and a unique representation that fits there, so you get a unique assignment that fits with the HII conjecture of the Langlands parameter phi to this representation, the induced of this G2-1, this cuspidal. And okay, so now So this turns out to work always. So there is a theory which is due to Mark Rieder for G exceptional split, and it's due to Yongqi Fan and myself in general. And it says that okay, let sigma be a cuspidal unipotent character. Of the reduction of P of PU, where PU is a maximal Frobenius U stable parabolic. Then there exists a unique up to the natural action of the unramified characters, or maybe quasi-unramified characters group, which is the Pontryagin dual of the theta invariance in the group omega on the space of Langlands parameters. A unique up to this action discrete unramified Langlands parameter phi for G. Such that the equation star that we have holds. So that the formal degree is the formal degree predicted by HII with that language. And so in the language of Anne-Marie, this language parameter has a custodial enhancement. So in language. So this phi has a custodial enhancement, which in the language of Lustig means that there exists a cuspidal local system on the corresponding unipotent orbit. And the remarkable thing is that if you insist on some very natural equivalences for the action of this group, but also on the dual affine diagram, you have so this acts on the dual affine diagram, which is sort of the diagram that governs the Langlands parameters, but you also have an action of omega theta acts on the set of unipotent irreducible unipotent characters which are discrete series. In a natural way, and then there is some action of the Frobenius on the cuspidal unipotent representations of finite groups of Lie type, which you have to match with characters of certain how do you call these things? Borel de Siebenthal. So you get Borel de Siebenthal central extensions for certain Langlands parameters that are related to endoscopic group, and then you have to match the Frobenius eigenvalue in the finite group of Lie-type distance of Lustig with the central action on the character for the corresponding Langlands parameter. But so these are all quite natural matching conditions, and if you do that, then you get that this is unique up to choosing base points in the orbits of all these groups. So it's remarkable how much information for the cuspidal case you can get from only looking at these formal degrees, essentially up to choosing. So for example, you have to choose the extension of a cuspidal representation of P to its normalizer. Well, this is typically a thing, right, that gives you a base point. And then there is an action of this group, which rotates these things around. On the other hand, you have on the Langlands parameter, you have these groups acting, and you have to choose base points for that. But then things are fixed. So that's the cuspidal case, and that is a sort of the base for the theory of spectral transfer maps, which is a theory of inducing this in some sense. So it's very closely related to what Anne-Marie is doing. So I want to stop here.
Any questions? Okay, let's thank Eric again.